and I'm Dr. Trevor Cates. Welcome to the Spa Doctor Show, where we talk about health tips and strategies to help you be smart, sexy, and strong. On today's show, I have as my guest Dr. Harry Adelson to talk to us about stem cell therapy. Dr. Harry Adelson began his training in prolotherapy in 1998 while in his final year at the National College of Naturopathic Medicine. During his residency training in integrative medicine at Yale Griffin Hospital in Derby, Connecticut, he volunteered after hours at a large homeless shelter in Bridgeport, Connecticut, providing prolotherapy to the medically underserved while gaining valuable experience. He opened Doceri Clinics in Salt Lake City, Utah in 2002, and from day one, his practice has been 100% regenerative injection therapies for the treatment of musculoskeletal pain conditions. Since February of 2010, Dr. Adelson has performed over 2,000 bone marrow and adipose-derived adult stem cell procedures, placing him among those most experienced in the world with the use of autologous stem cells for the treatment of musculoskeletal pain conditions. Dr. Adelson practices now in Park City, Utah, and is a diplomat of the American Academy of Pain Management. On today's show, Dr. Adelson discusses regenerative injection therapies and adult stem cell therapy. He shares with us why stem cells are so valuable and how he obtains stem cells from his patients and successfully uses them in treatments. We talk about the various uses of stem cell therapy from pain management to anti-aging treatments for skin. So enjoy the show.
Welcome to the show, Dr. Adelson.
Thank you so much.
So let's start off with your background and your training. How did you get into naturopathic pain medicine?
Well, when I was in my first year at National College of Naturopathic Medicine, I had a shoulder injury. I tore the labrum in my shoulder rock climbing. I saw a surgeon and he said, well, you know, I can go in, I can snip out the torn piece. It might help, it might make it worse, but you're definitely going to have arthritis later. And he actually said, I would suggest that you look into prolotherapy. And I asked around and I found a naturopathic doctor, Rick Marinelli, who was a very accomplished prolotherapist. And he injected me with a dextrose-based solution. The idea being that you inject a natural substance that's slightly irritating, tricks your body into thinking that you've had an injury, and you launch your body's own natural healing cascade. Well, that was back in 1995, and it cured the problem. And I fell in love with Rick, and I fell in love with the therapy, and I knew from that time that's what I wanted to do. So during my time at NCNM, at National College, which you were my classmate.
Yeah.
I studied under Rick. I studied under some of the other leaders, and I knew from the time I graduated that I wanted to be a prolotherapist and practice regenerative injection therapy, which then evolved into the other modalities, the platelet-rich plasma, and then ultimately the stem cells, which is mostly what I'm doing now.
Well, that's great. Yeah. So we were in school together, and what you're doing is very different than what most naturopathic doctors do. And you do this full time. You don't do the traditional naturopathic medicine, right, in your practice?
That's right. I don't have the attention span for it, so I leave the hormones and everything else to people like you. Yeah, I only treat pain. I only treat chronic musculoskeletal pain and using injection therapies. And naturopaths do have a rich history of regenerative injection therapies. So the term regenerative injection therapies is a sort of a broad spectrum that it involves a hypodermic needle and then some form of natural substance, whether it comes out of a vial or comes out of the person's own body, with the goal being to trigger the body's natural healing response, which is why it is, in fact, a very naturopathic modality. It very closely adheres to the naturopathic philosophy of using the body's natural ability to heal itself. So naturopaths have done prolotherapy and other regenerative injection therapies for a long time. And I decided from the time I was in school to just only do that because I feel like it's what I'm good at and it's what I love. And rather than try to be good at a lot of things, I decided to be good at one thing.
Mm-hmm. And you are really good at it. I refer patients to you and they have great results. And I know people travel from all around the world to come see you in Park City. So it's great having you here in Park City. So let's talk about the different types of regenerative injection therapies. What you mentioned, prolotherapy and PRP and stem cell therapy. So let's go through each one of those. Start with prolotherapy.
Sure. Well, regenerative injection therapy and prolotherapy really are interchangeable terms.
Okay.
Prolotherapy is the original term, and regenerative injection therapy is slightly more descriptive, so it's become more popular. The most basic prolotherapy solution is using a dextrose-based solution, usually a 12.5% dextrose. So after oxygen, sugar is the most important nutrient to the body. We need sugar to survive to some degree. And but if you have it at 12.5%, that's quite a bit more concentrated than what the normal tissue environment is. So when you inject that, it's simultaneously nutritive, but then it is a little bit irritating too because it's hyper-concentrated. So by introducing that fluid, that just that in and of itself mimics the swelling associated with an acute injury, and then having the solution being a little irritating, your body thinks you've had an injury at the site of that injection. Platelets come to the area in response to that. Platelets are what are responsible for clotting after a cut or a bruise or any kind of wherever there's damage to blood vessels. But additionally, they release proteins that then signal cells in the rest of your body to come to the area. And that's really where the tissue healing occurs. So then in 2006, we started hearing about guys injecting platelet-rich plasma. And so Michael Cronin, who's the founder of the Southwest College of Naturopathic Medicine and the past president of the American Association of Naturopathic Physicians, he got a group of us together and he brought in the guy who at the time, this guy David Crane, who's an MD in Kansas City, to teach us how to use platelet-rich plasma. And the idea is very simple. The component in blood that's responsible for signaling the body to heal, those proteins are in the platelets. So if we take the blood and just put it in a simple centrifuge and then concentrate the platelets and inject the platelets, that's going to dump all these protein signals. Now your body really thinks there's been an injury. And the main mechanism is by telling your bone marrow and your fat to release stem cells that are normally hibernating to go into circulation, go to that area, and then go to work. Well, then in 2010, I heard about guys actually just taking bone marrow. And bone marrow is one of the major sources of stem cells in the body. And I thought, okay, well, I got to find out about this. So I went to a guy named Joe Parita's office in Boca Raton, Florida, and learned how to aspirate bone marrow, which sounds very violent and scary, and it's really not that done to me, and I know what it feels like. And I've, at this point, I've done it to over 2,000 people, and people get through it just fine. But the idea is now just go right to where the business is. We take the stem cells out of the bone marrow, and then using X-ray guidance, place the needle exactly where the problem is. So whether that's something simple like inside an arthritic knee or something a little more complex like into an intervertebral disc, we inject, and those stem cells then come into contact with the damaged cells, and they recognize that those cells are damaged, and then they go to work. They release all these different proteins that signal growth of new connective tissue. And then this last summer, the newest form of prolotherapy that we're doing, which is really what I'm mostly doing now, and it's what I'm mostly excited about, is instead of doing a bone marrow aspiration, we do liposuction that we call a lipoaspiration.
We do liposuction. Sorry, cut out for just a second so I want people to hear that.
We do a miniature liposuction, so we call it lipoaspiration. So if somebody has cosmetic liposuction, they're going to have between 1 and 6 liters of fat removed. So a liter of fat is 1,000 cc's. So they have between 1 and 6,000 cc's removed. Well, I'm just going to take a very small amount. I'm going to take between 60 and 100 cc's. So that's about enough fat to fill a small coffee cup. We take that fat and then we process it over a period of about an hour. We add an FDA-approved enzyme called collagenase because the stem cells are very tightly adhered onto the fat cells. So we add this enzyme and then incubate it up to body temperature in test tubes. And that allows the stem cells to loosen off of the fat cells. And then we put it in the centrifuge. And then in this 50 ml tube of fat, after it's been in the centrifuge, at the very bottom, all the fat goes to the top, and then at the very bottom is what we call a pellet of stem cells. Draw that into a syringe, and now we have approximately 3 million stem cells. That's mostly what we've been doing lately since we started doing it, because when given the option between a bone marrow aspiration and a little bit of liposuction, take a little off the sides. Most people will take the liposuction.
Right, right. Okay, great. So, and are everybody's stem cells the same? Like what are they different with different people and different ages, and how does that?
What's amazing about, so there's different types of stem cells. The most important for our purposes are the mesenchymal stem cells. Some people pronounce it mesenchymal. And the very interesting about them is while they do, you know, they're cells from our body, so clearly they contain DNA material, they contain proteins that disguise their presence. So one of the very interesting areas of study with mesenchymal stem cells is in autoimmune disease, and more than that, in organ transplants. Because when you introduce the mesenchymal stem cells, they release these proteins that essentially turn off the immune system in their presence. It's like a cloaking device. So it's being used when people are having like organ transplants, because the big concern when you have an organ transplant is that your body's going to reject it. Well, if you give somebody stem cells intravenously at the same time as an organ transplant, then it kind of shuts off that mechanism. So the question is, can you use them between different people? Are they different between different people? Well, legally in the United States, in order for me to give you stem cell therapy, it has to be from your body. It has to be autologous. The meaning of the word autologous is that donor and recipient are the same person. So if you come to me, I'm going to use it from you and give it back to you. But not only can it be used between people without having to match them, but some of the research that's being done in mice is they'll take human stem cells and use the human stem cells in mice, because that cloaking device works even between species, which is unheard of in any other different type of cell.
Wow. Wow, I didn't know that. That's amazing. So there are legal implications with that that hold you back from being able to use other people's, or to, you know, to have that flexibility. But really, that's for your purposes, in your clinic, it's best anyway to get them directly from that patient, right?
It really is safest. Yeah, it's the safest, because in order to use it between different people, you have to have a very high level laboratory that's capable of isolating the cells and then screening them. There's a whole lot that goes on. But if I just take them out of you and put them back into you, that's very safe. That's on par with like a hair transplant. It's considered a tissue transfer. So if you come to me and I take either some of your bone marrow or some of your fat out and then I put it back in, that's considered a tissue transfer, and that does not fall under the jurisdiction of the FDA. If I keep the cells overnight, now I'm a tissue bank, and that's a whole other deal. Or if they're from one person to another person, that's a whole other deal. Now it becomes a drug. Now your own cells become a drug, and it's a non-FDA approved drug. So as long as we do same day, same person, and we don't add any chemicals or tweak it or do anything to it other than just very simple centrifugation like we do, then we're well within the bounds of what is legal.
Right. So now we can kind of get into, we're touching on some of the controversy with stem cells. This is part of the problem that arises, is that people trying to, you know, use stem cells with other people, get them from different places and storing them. There are a lot of legal implications with that. So, but I want to talk about what stem cell therapy, what are these injection therapies used to treat specifically? What do you use them to treat?
Well, at my clinic, I'm really just treating chronic musculoskeletal pain. So about half of my patient load are people between the ages of 45 and 95 who have one or more worn out joints, just good old tear, osteoarthritis, bone on bone knees, bone on bone hips, that kind of thing, shoulders. People who do not, for whatever reason, do not want joint replacement or are not candidates for joint replacement. That's a big part of what we do. Very simple, very safe. The other half of my practice is spine. We treat a lot of low back pain, neck pain, post-whiplash syndrome, degenerated discs, anything that is pain of the spine that is not caused from cancer or some other systemic disease. So between those two, that's what we do. So we're targeting through the interview with the patient and then also physical exam. And then in the office, we have ultrasound and we have x-ray. And if we need to refer out for MRI, then we do that. We determine what the damaged structure is, what the pain generator is. And most often in musculoskeletal pain, what's causing the pain, what the pain generator is some form of degeneration. So like a ligament that's been overstretched and now it's kind of scar tissue, or if there's actual adhesions in the spinal canal, or if an intervertebral disc is dehydrated or something like that. This when we then inject the stem cells into those tissues, again, we're tricking the body into thinking it's been injured. It goes through a healing cascade. You grow new collagen fibers, and it becomes healthy functional tissue again. There's a lot of other conditions that you can treat with stem cell therapy. I don't do many of them just because I want to make my mark in my area. But there's guys around the country who are treating everything from autoimmune disease to chronic heart failure, or congestive heart failure, to COPD, to emphysema. I mean, pretty much you name it.
Wow. Wow. So how would someone know if they're a good candidate for doing a stem cell therapy? Is there anybody that wouldn't be?
Well, we treat most people. I mean, unless somebody has some sort of medical condition that really is where it's going to be dangerous for us to even touch them. But if someone has active cancer, then probably no one's going to want to take their bone marrow or their fat and start moving one tissue from one part of the body to another. Apart from that, it's really just the clinician's call and whether or not you feel like this person is fit for going through something, because it is going to elevate your heart rate and it is uncomfortable. And apart from that, we treat everything from elite athletes to diabetic, overweight people.
Right. And then you've also mentioned to me that it can be helpful for headaches, neck pain and headaches. Is that because of issues with the spine, things going on with the spine?
Well, when people have what's called cervicogenic headaches, which means headaches that's caused from problems in the neck, which is a very common cause. A lot of times people they describe the pain as right behind their eyeballs. And a lot of time those guys get worked up for chronic sinusitis, and that's not the problem. And maybe they've had multiple sinus surgeries and none of it has helped. A lot of times if someone has a whiplash injury and they have damage in their occipital region, that can put strain on the occipital nerve in the back of the skull, and that will cause a referral pain pattern to the front. So if somebody has headaches that's caused from irregularities in the neck, then yes, I actually do quite well with that.
Oh, that's great. And so then also people with joint pain, is it best for people, if they were going to come see you, is it better for them to get a diagnosis assessment first before they come in, or can you pretty much diagnose and assess the situation?
No, I prefer the people. Well, if they come to me and most people who come to me have been through the system. They've consulted with the orthopedic surgeon. Maybe they've had surgery. They've been to the interventional pain management specialist. I usually get people kind of at the end of the line who've tried all their options, and I'm the last stop. But no, we're capable of evaluating people and coming up with a diagnosis.
Okay, great. And then once people get the therapy, and at your clinic or wherever they go, what kinds of results should they expect to get? I mean, is it something that they have to come in regularly to get the treatments, or is it a one-time treatment?
Well, it depends on what it is we're treating, on the severity of the condition, there's certain things, but we don't help everybody. We help most people, and most people we help to a degree that they're satisfied. So occasionally we get people who have 100% pain relief. More often than not, it's a partial relief, but enough that it improves their quality of life, that they're able to go back to the activity doing before. They're able to bounce their grandkids. They're able to go up and down the stairs in their house. Most often, just sort of across the boards, most often we do one treatment, and then at a 2-month interval, we reassess and we might do a second treatment. And about half the time, we will do a second treatment at 2 or 3 months after the first. And then usually I'll see people like every couple of years. They'll do well, and I haven't seen them in 2 or 3 or sometimes 4 years, and they're in for just a single tune-up.
Mm-hmm. And do you ever work with kids, or is it just for adults?
I tend not to, just because what I work with is usually chronic conditions. So it's things that have happened over time. I've had a few kids in for sports injuries, but we're much more with the 45 and over crowd.
Mm-hmm. That's your mostly your demographic. Mm-hmm. Okay, and then you still do PRP and prolotherapy in addition to the stem cells. Are you just doing stem cells now?
Pretty much stem cells, because people, when they come to me, usually they've decided that they want stem cells. Platelet-rich plasma is a great modality, and it works. It just requires more treatment. We can get somebody better with old-fashioned dextrose prolotherapy, but it's going to take probably 12 treatments. Mm-hmm. PRP is very effective, but we're probably going to have to do 6 treatments. Bone marrow stem cells, we can get the same thing done in 2 treatments, and what we're finding with this, with the adipose-derived stem cells from the lipoaspiration, is we're getting it done in 1 treatment.
Okay. Wow. That's, I mean, it's so much more efficient to do it that way, right?
It just depends on the personality of the personality type. Because here in the Western U.S., people are a little brave, a little more brave, a little more tough, and they'd rather just get it done. Whereas my colleagues in the East, either come in 6 times, because there's no way you're going to do a bone marrow aspiration or a liposuction on them. They're too nervous about that. So, yeah, this part of the country, that's we mostly do stem cells.
And you certainly know, because you're from the East Coast. You're from New York, right?
Yeah, from New York. I'm from New York City, yeah.
And you work just in Park City, or are you working other places now too?
I'm just in Park City. I'm probably going to do a little bit. I'm starting to do a little work in Tempe, Arizona, starting in February or March. I'll be down there once a month. The Southwest College of Naturopathic Medicine is in the process of building a state-of-the-art clinic there that's beautiful, and they're putting in an x-ray suite that I've been involved with helping design. And so I'll be seeing I have a lot of patients who are Canadian who are summer in Canada and they winter in Arizona. And so I have a lot of my Canadians who want me to go there to them in the winter months. So yeah, starting in February or March, I'll be once a month in Arizona.
Are you teaching other people how to do what you do? Do you teach other practitioners, other doctors, or?
I have in the past. When what I was doing was simpler, I did a lot more. And now, you know, it used to just be I was doing PRP with ultrasound, and then it was bone marrow with ultrasound, and then suddenly the fluoroscopy came in, the motion X-ray, and so I've gotten to the point where stuff is complex enough that I feel more comfortable with people. I'll help people go get trained in the different things from the leading experts, but I'm not doing so much training myself these days.
Are there many people, many doctors doing stem cell therapy?
More and more. And there are more and more guys doing it. There's very few of us who have any experience with it. So if you're looking for someone to do it, just see what kind of background they have and see what kind of experience. There's a nationwide franchise for stem cell medicine where a doctor can essentially buy into the franchise and get a little bit of training. I think it's like a weekend training. And then they have this huge marketing machine behind them. So a lot of times, mostly, you know, those guys are usually very experienced conventional doctors and do whether it's interventional pain management or whatever, but they have no background in regenerative therapies, which really is a different thing. I mean, it's with these therapies, it's really not just a matter of exchanging cortisone for bone marrow. There's more to it than that. So, you know, if you're looking for somebody, just look at their background, make sure they have a background in regenerative medicine.
And background in regenerative medicine. And mm-hmm. Is there an association or any kind of resource where people can go to find someone that's trained in that?
It's tricky. Usually, you know, the biggest group is the American Association of Orthopedic Medicine, AAOM. That's sort of the biggest prolotherapy group. But, you know, there is no board specialty for this, and it is a little bit of a Wild West. So, you know, the best is also to see who you know who've been and where they've been and what kind of experience they've had.
Right. So referrals from other people, other doctors in your area, or just fly to Park City and see Dr. Harry.
It's beautiful this time of year.
Right. Absolutely. All times of year, I think. Mm-hmm. And Park City, it's a great place for you to be, I think, because it's a very active community. People do push themselves skiing and all the outdoor sports, and so they get injured. They want to keep going too, especially as we get older, over 45, especially even over 40, our bodies start to get that wear and tear, start to get more aches and pains. but we want to keep going. So it's great to have you here, but it's not just Park City, right? People come from all around the world.
We're about 50% Canadian at this point, which is really interesting. And it's because in Canada, the way their system works, it's the best in the world for emergency care and preventive care. But for something like a knee replacement, it's a 3 to 5 year waiting list. Wow. So those guys, if they want something done sooner, the deal is they go to the U.S. and insurance doesn't pay for it. So they're accustomed to that. And so, yeah, we're treating a lot of Canadians right now.
That's funny. Okay. Now, we could use stem cells for aesthetic purposes, too, for skin and anti-aging, those sorts of things. So do you do any of that? Can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. So what causes the aging in the face? So the major components of aging of the skin of the face are the lines of facial expression, loss of volume, and loss of elasticity. So the lines of facial expression, the muscles in the face, in the skeletal muscles in the rest of the body, the muscles attach bone to bone, and that's what's responsible for motion of our skeleton. In the face, the muscles of facial expression, the muscles connect skin to skin. So that's what allows us to frown and scrunch our foreheads and these things. And it's like bending a credit card. You know, over time, you do it enough times, you bend the credit card a couple of times, you see it a little bit, but the more you do it, the deeper it gets. Well, that's what happens with your skin. You keep scowling and eventually you develop these deep lines here. That's what Botox does. Now, stem cells is not a replacement for Botox. If you want to paralyze those muscles so you quit making that motion, quit bending the credit card, then you need Botox. If someone wants fuller lips, or if they want to fill the lines, it's called the nasolabial fold, naso, nose, labial, like the lips, then that requires a filler. But for the thinning, for the dehydration, for the loss of elasticity, the aging of the skin, that's something that stem cells are excellent for. So you can do it with platelet-rich plasma, you can do it with bone marrow stem cells, you can do it with adipose-derived stem cells, but it's taking these biologic substances and just doing very superficial injections with a tiniest needle made, the smallest needle manufactured. It's about like an acupuncture needle, but it's a hypodermic needle. Lots of little tiny injections just right under the skin, which will trigger the growth of new collagen and thereby restoring the elasticity and the hydration of the skin.
Wow. And what are the results like for that?
Oh, they're good. I'm always impressed with it. It takes a while for it to kick in because it's like if you take a medicine to grow new hair, it takes a while for the hair to grow in. So it's not like Botox or a filler where the results are very, well, Botox takes a couple of weeks, but filler is immediate. Mm-hmm. This, you do it, and at first there can be a little bit of bruising, but then it looks kind of back to the way it was, and you think, wow, that was a complete waste of time. And then all of a sudden, 6 weeks later, people are saying, gosh, you look great. Are you sleeping well, or what's the story? And then the results continue to improve over a period of months.
Well, and that's not something that's going to wear off like Botox, right?
Right. Correct. Yeah. It's the opposite. It's not something where you do it and then it wears off after 6 months. This lasts years.
And then how often would people need to go back in for something like that?
Well, just when it starts to wear off again. I mean, most of the people we've done, it has literally been like 3 or 4 years before they want another treatment.
Wow. Wow. Is that because of the pain or the results?
It's not that painful, surprisingly.
Okay.
Yeah, so there's a way to do it. If you do it right, it's actually not that bad.
Okay. And do you do that in your practice?
We do some. You know, I really, again, I'm trying to make my mark as a pain guy. So I do it on, you know, sort of existing patients who I'm treating for pain to begin with. But sure, you know, we do it.
Yeah. And are there other doctors that specialize in this that do stem cell just for aesthetic purposes? Is that becoming a popular trend?
That I'm aware of in Utah, but oh, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. It's, and it's used a lot too in conjunction with fat transfer. Cause when you do a fat transfer, whether it's, you know, you can do it in the face as instead of a Restylane, instead of some kind of hyaluronic acid filler, you can put fat in the face. You can use it for breast augmentation. You can use it for buttock augmentation. When you do that,
fat transfer is what you're talking about.
Right, mm-hmm. You can do a fat transfer where you're just taking whole fat and putting it in one, taking it from one part of the body, putting it somewhere else. And that's been around a long time. And the only pitfall with that is only if you just take the fat and move it, you're only about 40% of what you transfer is going to actually graft. You lose 60% of the fat that you move because it just dissipates. Well, if you prepare stem cells, and they call, the guys who are doing it are calling it supercharge it. So you take much more fat than you're going to transfer. And this fat, you just take the stem cells out of it, and then this is the fat you're going to transfer and supercharge the fat with the stem cells, and then transfer it, you get a much higher transfer rate. So, you know, you're going to, the amount that you introduce is what you're going to be end up with, much closer to that.
Wow, fascinating. Okay. Well, it's great. It's great to know that there are these other options. There are so many different options, and that stem cells, we can actually get them and use them. And we have other solutions to pain management rather than shoulder and knee replacement, hip replacements, and surgeries that don't always work, right?
Yeah, well, the thing about joint replacement is when they work, they're great. But boy, when things go south, it can be a real heartbreak. And, you know, if it's 1 in 5,000 that something could go wrong, if it happens to you, it's 100% and it's you and you're stuck with it. So what I like about what I do is, you know, I don't make people worse. The worst thing that's going to happen is it's not going to help, which, you know, most people can live with that. And then you still have the option of surgery.
Right. So ideally people would come see you before they get surgery. But if they have already gotten surgery and it didn't work out very well, can they still come see you and get benefit?
You bet. Yeah, that's a big part of what we do is what we call failed low back syndrome or failed back surgery syndrome. You know, when you have surgeries, a lot of times people, it'll help the problem they went in for, but now they have a new kind of back pain. So they had a disc that was poking out and they had a discectomy or maybe they had a fusion and it helped with the nerve pain going down the leg, but now they've got pain from the scar tissue from all the where they've been cut on in their back. So yeah, we see that a lot.
Okay. Well, thank you so much, Harry. Tell us how people can find you, how they can schedule to come and see you.
Well, what we prefer is that people read the website thoroughly before they call us because, you know, everything actually is fairly simple. And if you read over the website once, you're going to have a pretty good understanding of what it is we do. I mean, it's not terribly scientific. It's really quite logical. So if people look over it, then call our office and talk to either Dixie or Wendy or Jen. And they can answer all their questions. Then if people want to do a phone consult, especially if they're out of state and they want to, you know, sort of feel me out and talk to me before they pull a plane ticket, then we just do a 30-minute phone consult and make a plan.
Yeah,
but the website is docereclinics.com, D-O-C-E-R-E, clinics, one word, docereclinics.com.
Okay, and we'll also have that up on my website near the podcast, on the podcast page, so people can go to the link there too. And you're used to people coming in from out of town, so you guys are really accommodating for helping them find a place to stay and do all that, right?
We chose, part of the reason we chose the location of our clinic is we're directly across the parking lot from a very comfortable hotel where we have a corporate rate. It's the New Park Hotel. And so it's like 25-minute drive from the Salt Lake City Airport. Salt Lake City Airport's a major hub. It's, you know, there's 6 flights a day to New York. There's direct flights to Paris. It's a very good airport. It's very easy to get in and out of. We can set up a car service. People come up, stay at the New Park, and it's a gorgeous. If you can make a little bit of a vacation out of it, all the better. Because
yeah, people.
I don't have to tell you about Park City.
I know. I'm in Park City too. Yeah, and a lot of times people think of Park City as being such a remote location, but it really is an easy place to get to because Salt Lake City Airport, like you said, it's only 25 minutes away. So it's a major city. So you know, it is easy to get to you. So thank you so much, Dr. Harry. I really appreciate all your information, and I'm so amazed with everything you're doing. I mean, we graduated how long ago?
I'd rather not say.
It's been great seeing you excel so much in this naturopathic pain medicine. So great work. Thank you, Harry.
Thank you for joining us today. I hope you enjoyed this interview with Dr. Harry Adelson. If you want to learn more about Dr. Adelson, you can go to his website, docereclinics.com, or you can visit my website, drtrevorcates.com. Visit the podcast page in his interview, and you'll see all the information there. Thanks again for joining in, and have a great day.